Well, hello, good afternoon to the people who have deliberately entered this room to watch my talk. Very much welcome, and to the people wanting to socialize in the room as well, well, welcome to you as well. I will talk about web analytics and why I think that besides the regular social media type of attention for privacy disrupting technologies, analytics is a part of the web that, well, not that much attention has gone towards, especially since I see a lot of open source projects also using commercial analytics software. Apologies for my voice. It's on and off all day, so I will try to keep the microphone in this position as good as possible. But if you at some point can't hear me, please just signal and I will reiterate. Also, if you have any questions during my presentation, please fire away, just ask. I love a bit of audience interaction. That also is an indication to me that you haven't all fallen asleep yet. So by all means, interrupt me. First of all, thanks to the organization, Doug and all the volunteers. You guys are doing an awesome job. I have some experience in this field, as you may know or not know. I was project lead for openSUSE Conference 2015 in The Hague, my beautiful hometown, which a lot of you actually attended. Thanks for that. It's a lot of work that goes into such a conference, and it's an amazing job that they pulled off again, so thanks. Well, who am I? For those of you, my name is Hans de Raad. I have a company called openNovations, which basically does whatever I find interesting and with which I can find a customer, which is a lot of stuff. I teach at the University of Applied Sciences in The Hague. I do consultancy, I perform security tests, I do implementation projects, and I'm the Dutch partner for Colab Systems. So if you at some point might feel that I mention the word Colab sometimes, well, that might be intentional. So just for the start, so you know. And for me, it's dreadfully important to have a picture of my car in there. This is the Bismarck. I love my car. And actually, I think it very much underlines the things that, since my car was built in 1975, have occurred in the rest of the technological world as well. Georg mentioned the Tesla effect. Well, I think my car is pretty much the last example before the Tesla effect of an open car. Basically, you can rebuild this car with just mechanical tooling. If you have, for instance, a very sophisticated 3D printer nowadays, and if you have the schematics of the car, you will be able to rebuild this car from scratch. There is no real technology in there, so if you wonder, why does an IT nerd like me drive a car like that? Well, that's a rhetorical question. I work with computers all day, so I want something that works. And my car does work, usually. The other thing is that I can bring my car to any dealer or any garage in, well, basically the world. And any garage with any knowledge of mechanics and principal car technology will be able to service my car. And if you try that with a modern car nowadays, well, you don't buy a car nowadays. Actually, you buy a service subscription to your local dealer. Because pretty much the only one able to connect to your car and diagnose any problem will be your own brand dealer, because of the simple reason it's all been proprietary. So open source goes quite up to a fundamental level in my daily life, including my car. And that also was a shameless plug for putting more beautiful cars on the road. So where does Drupal come from? Well, It's very simple. From my point of view, Drupal has been the go-to platform for any type of website-related activity for the past at least 7-8 years. That doesn't mean that I don't use other platforms or that I don't try other stuff. But in general, whenever my company does something with a website or web development, it will be on Drupal. And that's not only because of the technology, which I think is pretty good, especially now with Drupal 8, they've been working together with the Symfony community. They're really getting off the island. They're building all kinds of reusable components in the greater Symfony ecosystem. So it's very interesting developments in there. But for Drupal, the community for me has also been great. Drupal has a slogan, come for the software and stay for the community. Well, in that aspect, I think there's a lot of overlap between openSUSE and Drupal for that instance, because the community of openSUSE basically is also one hell of an interesting bunch of people. But I'm not going to talk about community all the time. I'm going to talk about laws, damn laws, and statistics, and cookies, and stuff, and Piwik, and Drupal-y things. First of all, why do we even bother? Why do we see such a strong movement in the EU towards privacy-related questions? Why is it that basically the whole privacy discussion is dominated by this continent? And of course, there's some very vocal parties in the US as well. There's some very vocal communities in the US as well. But especially on a government level, there's virtually no serious discussion going on regarding privacy issues in the US versus the EU. I find that interesting. I think it has something to do maybe with our history in the past 70 years of having a couple of incidents in which statistical analysis and privacy issues, especially also in the communist areas of Europe, have been a bit of an issue, and maybe not, I'm not sure. We do bother, we do take our privacy very seriously, and we even take it sometimes up to a ridiculous level. I think, because what I will tell you now about the history of the Dutch cookie law and legislation we invented in the past 2 years, we've basically created our own minefield of laws regarding something that's unimplementable, but with the best intentions. But the biggest picture, I think, is that the EU is becoming more self-aware. Self-aware in the sense that up until about 10 years ago, the EU and a lot of the academic circles in the US, but primarily the EU as a whole, were very much into open collaboration with the whole world. We would share our technology, we would share our knowledge, we would share our institutions, etc., with the whole world. But in the past decade, we've also seen some movement in which, well, basically that openness and that trust has been, at some points, well, maybe a bit betrayed. I mean, we have had the Snowden revelations, and before that, we've also had many issues of commercial espionage, and also we've seen the rise of the big internet platforms like the big walled gardens like Facebook and Google and Amazon, well, which basically can only exist because they work with our data. And the EU started to realize at some point that if we continue on this path by giving away our data, then, well, it's very simple. We hurt ourselves pretty badly on an economic sense as well. So, and then we came up with the new privacy directive, which includes one very interesting aspect, I think, namely the right to be forgotten. And the right to be forgotten, the first reaction in the tech community was, well, what kind of bullshit is that? How can that be? How can the internet forget? Well, of course, from a technological point of view, it's a very tough question to answer. But from a social point of view, it's a very valid question. Because if you turn back time to the time when my car was built in like 1975-ish, then at that point in time, you could, as a human being, literally be forgotten and or forgiven. And especially the last bit is important to remember. Because as a human being, we all do stupid stuff. As a human being, we make mistakes. As a human being, we sometimes side with parties that turn out to be, well, less than ideal. But how can you achieve such a level of forgiveness as a society, as an individual, if no one ever forgets? If at every point in time, you will be haunted by your past. I'm very happy that I grew up in a time when I was a child until about my 10th, 12th birthday. That was the time when I came online. Before that, actually, there's virtually no social history of me, and all the stupid shit that I pulled back then is forgotten and forgiven. I'm not sure. How do you feel about that? How does that make you feel? That every step you always take is now and will always be available online. That doesn't make me feel very comfortable. So the principal discussion regarding the right to be forgotten, I very much applaud and I very much support. The technical implementation is something else though. So in the Netherlands, we've done an attempt at creating legislation to at least try to identify certain types of information that an analytical party or a website should and should not be able to register and or use. We tried to make a difference, and you will probably notice right away that this law was not built by a technician. This law was built by a politician, or a lot of politicians, which basically makes it not implementable at all, but still, the idea is nice. Because there is a distinction between functional and analytical cookies. And functional is something that you actually need to run your website, like a session cookie, or like a search query, or like a shopping cart or something. And you have an analytical cookie. And that's basically everything you use to track your visitor. Or in most content management systems, you will see that the session cookie is basically the connection point for everything. But still, the idea is that make a distinction between something you as a user benefit from, namely the functional cookie, and something else, which is the analytical cookie. And we've even tried to create a system of penalties. We've even came up with repercussions for parties not involved. There was, however, a little bit of a pitfall, which is basically that the internet tends not to stop at the Dutch border. Yes, that may come as a surprise, at least to the politicians, but the internet appears to be a global thing. Let this just sink in for a bit. So it's quite hard to actually penalize some kind of Russian e-commerce website or a Chinese e-commerce website if the Chinese government doesn't recognize your law. That might be a fee, but still, the discussion was nice. But then, of course, what happens? Politicians tend to second-guess their own ideas, and they started to re-implement, or at least to try and make it a bit more practical. So then, instead of the functional and analytical distinction, came the first party and third party distinction. And this is something I very much applaud. I like this a lot, because it basically means that as long as you're the owner of the platform and the data on the platform, be that both the analytical platform and the web platform itself, then you're in a lighter regime for data management than you would be when using a third-party service, which is awesome, because host it yourself and you can do a lot more. The thing was, however, that, well, some things went a bit wrong-ish, because especially the Dutch government itself used Google Analytics on several websites. And the Dutch Public Broadcasting Service, for instance, they had to put up, that's a picture of my cat, by the way, just to test if you're still awake. The Dutch Public Broadcasting Service actually has the obligation by law to inform the Dutch public of well, newsworthy events, but due to the first-party and third-party cookie implementation or legislation, they actually had to put up a cookie wall first before they could perform their informative duties. And that conflicts, because, well, they should be open for everyone. There should be no boundaries and no blocking of any kind before you should be able to access public broadcasting information. But, well, the public broadcasters also wanted to have analytics on their website. So what happened then? Well, they started to use open platforms. And that's the discussion you saw at first, which happened in the Netherlands about 3 years ago. Sites were being completely blocked with a cookie wall before you would be even able to continue using the website. And a lot of websites actually said, well, screw that, I'm going to go with the plaudits that I already have, namely Google Analytics, and I'm just going to sit this one out. So, screw the law. But then it became worse, because actually the EU Privacy Directive, which is coming up soon, does the same thing and requires you to make the same announcements to your user or offer the same type of controls to your user, namely an opt-out or even an actual opt-in to be tracked. And, well, ask this question to yourself. How many times would you been, if you would be given the question, would I like to be tracked on this website or not? How many times would you press yes? Well, I'm pretty sure none of you will do that quite often. I won't. But then you can't use the website. It's basically the same thing with the payment rule. But there's a number of other use cases where you want to look, where you would want to look at other platforms like Google Analytics as well. Because what if you want to analyze something that's not directly connected to the internet? What if you want to run analysis on your corporate intranet? What if you want to run analysis on some restricted parts of your website? What do you want to do then? Because some of you may know that 2 years ago I spent some time in hospital, and what I found out then was that my healthcare insurance provider, on their website, on the restricted part of their website, which I had to log into using my social security number and some other really confidential stuff, they embedded Google Analytics in the restricted area of my healthcare provider's website. I did not find that a very comfortable idea, because for some reason, I imagine that I will never get another offer, a special offer from any healthcare insurance provider for the rest of my life. But the same is regarding other parties, because especially from the analytics part, you can construct a very, very accurate picture of the daily life of a person, because they all use the same analytics platform. Your supermarket uses it, and your supermarket also has some kind of loyalty program, which, well, basically will know how much wine or alcohol or French fries or frozen pizza you will buy in a week. And your sports club will use the same analytics platform as well. So correlating all that information That's a very detailed picture. But not only that, that picture will tell a lot of other things as well. Recently, we've had some data leakage, by now it's a couple of years ago already, from like the Ashley Madison website. Do you know Ashley Madison? The website for people who want to cheat on their wives, or wives who want to cheat on their husbands. And the first reaction of a lot of people when those accounts were leaked onto the internet was like, oh, well, that's good because people shouldn't cheat on their spouse. Oh, yeah, okay, fair enough, they shouldn't. But consider that in some Middle Eastern countries, the penalty for cheating on your spouse is actually the death penalty. And don't you think that's a bit harsh? And another thing, if people know your sexual preference, because your analytical platform will know that you visit, let's say, certain sites for gay people, like the shooter in Orlando, for instance. But in some cultures, that's also punishable by law. Now, what happens if that information goes out? What happens then? I don't know. Why should that information, and I think that's the principal question, why should that information all be registered in one place at all? What's the benefit for the user of the analytics platform at all? There's none. There's only a benefit for Google, because they can resell the information. Functional-wise, there's not so much of a benefit. So what should you do? Look into Piwik. Look into other open analytics platforms. Because from a functional point of view, they will offer you pretty much the same as Google Analytics does as well, but then hosted on your own environment, so you don't have the headache of have to require consent or anything else. You can create your own reports, you can create your own filters, you can even import your static server logs into Piwik as well, and that gives you an even more complete picture, and that's actually allowed to do. So, really, take a look at it. Who here has already done anything with Piwik? Who knew about Piwik before this talk? Cool. Excellent. What I find really interesting is that a lot of open source projects use a commercial analytics platform. And a lot of open source projects actually also use a proprietary email platform. And a lot of open source platforms even use proprietary code repository platforms. How does that, how is that compatible with being open source? Is that like the not in my backyard effect for open source platforms or something? I don't know. I think it's interesting because I think being an open source project, being in a community and being out there and sharing your thoughts should also mean that you take responsibility for your own platform as well, and you don't force your users to use proprietary tools to use your open source projects. That sounds contrary, right? So, dear open source projects, please start using open source tools like Colab for your email, Piwik for your analysis, because it will actually help you a lot, and it can do. Piwik is actually targeted as being a legally compliant platform for statistical analysis. It can anonymize IP addresses, because under the new EU privacy directive, an IP address is also considered to be personally identifiable information. And it can do a lot more. And basically, if it doesn't do something that you want, build it yourself. Are there any alternatives? Absolutely. I've taken a look at Open Web Analytics, which is not that bad, but it doesn't have all the privacy features Piwik does. We have CrawlTrack, but it's a bit dead. And CrawlTrack I find very suspicious, because they claim to be not only a statistical analysis platform, but they also claim to be a web application firewall thingy, like mod security. I have no idea why you would want your analytics platform to also be a web application firewall. Actually, I don't. And then you have the old server tools like AWS that's webalizers, but basically they all look like the control panel for Apollo 11, so just don't even go there. And, well, Drupal, I've already talked about that a bit. The nice thing about Piwik is that there's very nice integration with Drupal and WordPress and Joomla for your content editors. So you give them the power of Piwik when they're editing the content. They can actually see, when they're editing a page, what the statistics for that page are, what the entry points for your websites are, what the follow-up pages for that specific page are. If your search function does find the keywords that you've entered into the page. So it's very convenient for your site editors to enable something like Piwik. And that level of integration is something that's actually functioning on a higher level than what Google currently has to offer. So it's really nice. For demos, it's always dangerous to do such a thing because you have to hope that the network works, and I just had a bit of an issue, and since I only have 2 minutes left, demo.piwik.org. Go and have a look. Play around with it. It's really user-friendly. It's really very easy for the users to create their own dashboards, create their own filters, and everything like that. And if you already use some other tool, don't worry. You can probably import it into Piwik as well. So start with it and start using it. And we need more force with sunglasses, just to be sure. Any questions? I have a minute. I can tell you all want to get started with Piwik right away, so probably there are no questions on this part. So thank you for being here, thank you for listening, and I hope to talk to you later on the conference during a beer or something.